Good evening, members. Everyone okay to begin?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. So I have apologies for Councillor Brian McKenney, Warren Moore, as well as Co-Opty, Julie Johnson, and Chris Penn, as well as Valerie from CWP. And thank Irene and Denise for that. Are there any other apologies? There's one other absence that I'd like to address, and that's the absence of Walter Smith, who sadly passed away last week. He was an absolute gentleman, loved on the council, and he was involved with children's services since the beginning of his career on the council. And a former mayor of Wirral. Always turned up in style, and was always a contributor. So I'd just like to ask you all to join in the silence. So the first item on the agenda is the regular improvement plan update that we get. This will be the presentation from Deborah Corn. We received the presentation by
Councillor Bernie Mooney, the National Children and Adults Conference at the back
October, and I just want to raise a couple of points that were raised there. Along with the points that were raised was the launch of this document by the LGA. I have a couple of printed off copies this evening for people, but if you download this from the LGA's website, it really is worth a good read, and it puts us in a position in terms of where we sit with the wider pressures faced by children's services up and down the country. So I think it is worth you just having a look at that. I'll give you some information on the next Ofsted monitoring visit, which is due to take place in December, and the DfE, which is the Department for Education's visit, which will take place now in January. And then I will update you in terms of the recruitment, retention and staff engagement in terms of stabilising the workforce, which is a very key and critical agenda item for us in our improvement journey. Everything that we've talked about over the last 6 months has been a portion to how we have established the structure for the service, and I'm not going to take us too deeply into this because it has been brought up several times before, but it's in terms of this element here on the your right on your right talks about everything that happens in terms of the child's journey and lived experience, and that's the delivery arm of our business. The other section with the circles there is our enabling arm. So within there we've got quality assurance, we've got the business, the data, and we mobilise that in a different way. And that's quite pertinent just to remind us of as I take you through how we've come to the budget setting process, because we've become much more reliant on that business arm to make sure that we are setting a budget that is fit for purpose as we move forward on our journey. Okay, I mentioned that Bernie and I had been to the Adults and Children's Conference a few weeks ago. And some of the issues that we've picked up and some of the issues that come from this document, a few points that I just want to raise with you today on this visual. I want to take you through the top there where we see all the little people. It talks about 3 in 10 of our children are living in poverty. And what I want to say from that, we've always thought about poverty of children whose parents aren't in work and employment or in training. And that takes me back to the early Sure Start days where that was a big drag to push people forward. What I want to talk to you about today is, in terms of that, is that there are a quarter of those children who live in poverty who are living in families where parents are in work. And some of the key criticals around that are that there is a much bigger reliance on such as food banks. Many parents are still working where there are zero-hour contracts, and many parents have moved into a self-employed status, which all is putting pressure on children who clearly are still living on that poverty line. In terms of just talking about budgets at a national position, we've got a £2 billion funding gap that is predicted by 2020. That currently stands at about £635 million funding gap for children's services across the country. And we can see on the line underneath that where there's probably been a 40% reduction at a national level for services to children. Just some of the key points on there. We want to talk there just at the bottom, and I know that it could probably come up later this evening, in terms of our children who are in our schools who have got a diagnosed mental health condition. And it's 1 in 10 children in England is living with a mental health issue. I talk about children in school because we know that from an earlier age, the parental factors in terms of mental health issues affect our very youngest children. But our children at 11 and who are diagnosed between 11 and 18 with a mental health condition are likely to take that condition into adulthood with them. I think what's also quite pertinent in terms of the spend nationally, given that we've got about 75% of children who were diagnosed between 11 and 18, take that into adulthood, about 7% of spend on mental health budgets is spent on children. And I just thought that was something in terms of the poverty indicators and the other factors that impact on our children in ways that we don't really understand yet, is impacting survival risk to children, and it is quite a key critical. I'll just move us on in terms of Wirral's position. So I wanted to pick out a couple of points, and I know that this is something that may come up again in Maggie's presentation in a little while. So if we look at that, and we look at the poverty issues there, we've got 22 of our children who would be living below the poverty line. And what it talks about is 20 would be living in families in receipt of child tax credit and universal tax credit. So that shows the figures that we're dealing with locally. Another one that I would pluck out of there is that 14 would have a special educational need, and two of those children would have an education, health and care plan, and most probably for moderate learning difficulties, which is also can quite a key factor and quite significant in this area. And none of our children would not be in an education, employment or training. I'll come on to some of the factors around social care when I talk a little bit more about the budget setting process and the information that we've used as we get more data savvy. Okay, just take us on from there. Okay, so what's helped us in terms of the budget setting process and the information that we've been gleaning? We've heard very much over the last period of time, and particularly since Ofsted came to visit us, which is at the end of in July last year, so we've just been moving through our improvement plan for about 12 months since it was published in December last year. And in 2010, there's something quite significant in that we were an outlier. What I'll tell you about this diagram is that we've got, for every 10,000 children under aged 18, in Wirral, we had 92 for every 10,000 in 2010 who were a looked after child in the borough. And that was very, very high at the time, and we were seen to be an outlier. Now, that number by 2016, so it's just before or just around the point of Ofsted, that number had risen to 99 children per 10,000 who were living in the care system. I'll just bring you on to just underneath that, the statistical neighbours. At that point in 2010, our statistical neighbours average was that 67 children would be living in the looked after position, and 85 in 2016. So you can see the rise there in our statistical neighbours. And in the North West, and in England as a whole, has all moved on the upward trajectory. Our statistical neighbours, it's quite interesting, have gone up significantly. And I don't think that at that point we were going up in line with those, but we were still high because of our historic position. One of the things that's quite interesting about that position is that by August 2017 we'd moved up again, and at this point we haven't got the statistical neighbours information. But I do know that I can tell you it's all actually gone up in line with our own numbers. So in terms of from August 2017, just a year on from Ofsted, that rate had gone up to 120 children per 10,000 who were living in care. What I will say is over the last 12 months, we've done quite a lot of work around thresholds and understanding the need for children to come into care far better than we probably understood previous to that. And I would say that the children that are coming into care, that they need to be in the care system. So we're not taking children into care who shouldn't be there. And in fact, things at what we call our integrated RL front door are starting to stabilise. And we know that the children referred are children that should be referred. And children from those points of contact and referral that are taken into the care system are children that should come into the care system. And we know that because we are clearly reviewing and auditing the cases much more rigorously than we did previously. However, we continue to be an outlier in that we are still high, and our historic position is quite concerning, because if you look at that bottom line there, it tells us that nationally, 30% of children who were looked after are aged between 10 and 15. And for Wirral, this is 53%. The significance of that is that those children who are 10 and where children have been out of their family home for over 6 months, it is really hard, A, for us to put those children back into their own homes, or B, to place them in what we would call a permanent or a long-term arrangement, because of the nature of it being a 10-year-old, often with complex and challenging behaviours and need, and they're not the attractive children that people come to foster or to adopt. So in terms of our future modelling, and particularly around finance, we know that we've got 400 of our 800 children in the looked after system who are likely to be with us long term. So that's something that we will need to plan a programme for. That's not saying that all of those children, we won't bother and we won't enable them or to work with their families to return into their families and their communities, because we'll still do that. But there's a significant challenge around that particular age group of children which we have to do and look at in our long term care planning arrangements. I'm just going to look at this for a second in terms of our increasing rooms at the front door. And to say to you, whites are 10 to 15-year-olds are more challenging to return to families and to communities. And that we are taking the right children into care who are coming to our front door. That leaves us with an issue in terms of understanding which children we've got in care and which children we will start now to look to return home or to make alternative arrangements for with families at a community level and wrap support around those children, many of whom are in high-cost placements. And whilst we know that the cost of placements is not our first criteria, it is a criteria that we need to look at in order to enable our children to be in the right care settings and for us as an authority to be able to afford those long-term care needs. So everything has been of significant importance in terms of looking at how we establish a unit cost for a child who lives in the looked after system and how we establish unit costs for children who are child protection or child in need. So we're understanding things like our staffing criteria, our caseloads, placement costs, costs of working with children and our partners from a health perspective, all of where they're arising and the additional costs once a child is in those statutory arena. The big issue for us is around early help and what we do around making sure that our children and families are supported earlier on and before a statutory requirement is necessary. However, I just want to ask you to have a look at this with me for a few minutes. In terms of the top line there, that talks about our Northwest comparator and the Northwest comparator in terms of the maximum numbers of children looked after across a local authority. This isn't us, and you can see that in 2016, the local authority that I'm talking about had 164 children per 10,000. If I just click you back at that point, you'll see in 2016 we had 99 children per 10,000, and we think we are very high. And I put this on because we are not the highest, but children in the looked after system is not a place where we want our children to be, and we certainly don't want our children to languish in the looked after system, where we know that in a general sense outcomes are worse for our children who are in the care system. What we did in the red columns there, there's two red columns, one for 2016 and one for 2017, what we did is we looked at our own performance, we looked at our own population. And if we applied the figures to the local authority that was the highest in the Northwest, in 2016 we'd have had 1,110 children in care, and by 2017 we're already at 1,245 children in care. We then looked at our statistical neighbour, and the maximum for our statistical neighbour in 2016 was 113, and by 2017 it's probably more similar to us, and it's 129 per rate. That would give us in 2016 765 children, and by 2017 837. I'll just take you back again, as you can see that we were 92 and 99. The statistical neighbour average, however, was five, would have seen us at 577 and 624. These figures for all of these red columns, or sorry, all of these averages here, have also all gone up without exception. I think every local authority has gone up. It takes us right through in terms of the minimum northwest, which is 47 and 53, which takes us to 318 and 358. And we've used these to try and benchmark ourselves in terms of both establishing budget, but also about establishing a better place to be, and based on kind of evidence and technicalities around progress data that is over the local authorities have used, to have a look at how we should sit and where we should sit if we move to a position where we obviously aren't capping the number of children coming into the system, because we've already said that the children in the system who are coming in now need to be in, but actually looking at what we're doing in terms of applying more rigour for supporting children to come out through the system, and also to step children down from within the system. So from external placements, we would want our children to be near a home, from external foster care placements, where we want our children to be with our own foster carers, where we are driving the quality assurance around what happens when our children are in those environments. So what we've said is that by April 2018, we will look at our figures being about 850. We will reduce that again in 2019, and we've worked on a plan that should bring us near to these figures. And by April 2020, that should come down to 725. And if we continue further on, it will see us reducing year on year in terms of the application of the improvement work that we've currently got in situ. That will see us by 2010-20 reduce our children by 152, so taking it down approximately to 50 children a year from our current numbers. The target figure of 672 in 2021 will align well with predicted growth in statistical neighbour averages, so we've not just brought it down on the current position, but we're looking at the projections if they continue to go up. And what we're looking at there is our legacy issues, about changing why is Wirral an outlier, and why is Wirral always have more children in the Wirral tax system, and that's the bit that we're trying to change. So we think we've got it better now from the work that we've been doing over the last 12 months, but we still deal with a legacy issue of having more children in care. And if we were to sort those issues that we have always held, we will be in a different position in 3 years' time. So that helps us in terms of our improvement plan and our improvement journey. So from the improvement plan, this is not everything in there, it's quite a hefty document as people will appreciate, but we've pulled out some key critical factors that are part of the action plan to reduce the children looked after numbers. A big one is the 0-5 area edge of care. We're establishing an edge of care service, including the multiple pregnancy prevention work, and with an offer for services to undertake direct work with families in an intense way. And I think that this is something that we should have had our eye on for. I think some time ago, most people will know that our early years service went through quite a rigorous review, and now we're able to use the data and statistics that we didn't formally have to hand in the way that we have now, in a way that is driving children away from statutory interventions. One of the things in terms of the multiple pregnancy prevention work is working closely with partners and working at the point of a parent exposing that they already have a pregnancy. Not all of the families that we work with do that until very, very late in the pregnancy, which indicates there's no antenatal care, there's no family support, there's nothing changing from the previous pregnancy, and where we know that children will be taken into care previously for those families. So that's quite a big piece of work, very exciting piece of work. In line with that, and this is something that is becoming much more of a traditional way of working up and down the country, there are many, many models, but there's a restructure of the Youth Support Service, which is bringing together all services within that adolescent arena. Some have sat in statutory services and some have sat in Targeted, and we've brought that together to form an edge of care team to work at a community level and to prevent children from 11 where it is safe to do so by wrapping heavy support around families, stopping those children from coming into care, by stopping that family breaking down and getting to the point where it can no longer cope with the children that it is dealing with, which is often a main cause and issue for children. Once they start to exert themselves in those early teenage years, it starts to become more difficult for families where they're not coping particularly well anyway. Another factor is that we review all of the children under placement with parents over a 12-month period, and that is to consider discharge of the care order. When a child comes into care and is placed at home, it's usually an order that lasts for a very long time, if not for the life of that child's childhood, once a court order is made. So we're reviewing all of those placements to understand which children, with support and with the right level of support, could sustain and work and maintain their status within their family and without a court order wrapped around that. Because families that are doing okay in that kind of arena will do okay whether there's a statutory intervention or not. Having no statutory intervention is often better for a child who wants a court order wrapped around a child when there is no reason to have one, and we're being much more proactive working with our legal team in order to do some of that work. Review of the children placed on care orders to consider special guardianship orders. This is where children are in the care system, and to look again to see what's happening within that child's family, or where there may be different kinds of relationships for that child, where they would be better placed. To identify children and where that is clearly in the child's best interest. The public law outline and pre-proceedings review to improve efficiency and impact is also something that we're looking at and being much more proactive around. And that's obviously before children come into the care system, and looking at if any of these things further up, such as the edge of care services, support at community level, would be a better place for those children and families. We're also looking in terms of reunification work to support children to leave foster care and return to family and parental care where appropriate, and that's including a review of the fostering service. And the pre-birth liaison group will identify and provide immediate support prior to birth and work with children and families on that edge of care service further up the criteria and further down the age range in terms of getting in there early. So there's a lot of things that are happening and a lot of very proactive work that we are doing in order to mitigate against the number of children that we have in the system. Just come very quickly, this is probably old hats for a number of people now who have heard me tell our partners for a number of weeks now that we have our next Ofsted monitoring visit on the 11th and 12th of December, and the theme of the visit will be our children looked after, with a focus on permanency planning. So that's something that is obviously work that we are undertaking at the moment, so hopefully hand in glove should be able to start for evidence some progress being made in that area. I think this is a big area to look at. They've looked at that over four areas. That's advocacy support and representation for children open to social care. That's a very broad area. The personal education plans, which is how we ensure that children known to us have their educational needs in place. And the strengths and difficulties questionnaire, which again focuses on the earlier point in terms of how are children in terms of their health. What is the health position for those children, and particularly around mental health and well-being, which is considered during that strength and difficulties questionnaire being filled in by somebody that knows the child and with the child very well. It will look at our independent reviewing officers. This is something that was looked at last time, and particularly in respect of escalation with a focus on permanence, so where our children are stepping up in the thresholds. It will also look at the public court outline arrangements. I think that what's quite interesting there is that the work that we've got in our improvement plan and in our fast-tracked improvement plan around, and particularly coming around our budget setting and tying everything together, has taken into consideration a number of those facts. So early days for some of this work, but certainly in hand. We've got the DfE review. We have dates for that now, which was going to take place at the very beginning of December, which would have caused just a little bit of a bottleneck with some of the other work that we're trying to do. in terms of planning for the Ofsted visit, because we also had something called an ADCS, which is the Association for Director of Children's Services Peer Challenge, which is also another quite hefty process, and they all landed just in and around the same dates. So we haven't got a new date for the peer challenge, which was the same date as the Ofsted visit, and the DfE review will now be on the 24th and the 29th of January. We'll get further information near the time on that. And that's something that will be coordinated by Tom and Crane. So he's been very helpful in terms of moving those dates, because it's just we had everything over a two-week period, which just seems a little bit of clutter. And that's me, thank you.
Sit
down if anybody wants to take that. Okay, any questions for Deborah? Paul? Thanks, Deborah, for that beforehand providing it beforehand. I think that really is useful for members. I was quite interested to see that you shared the document from the ADCS. I think that was at the very beginning of your presentation. Specifically, there's all sorts of rationale for the slide. It seems to explain or attempt to explain it the way I see it anyway, the increase of looked after children, I think that'd be right in saying. And at the bottom there, it talks about children centres closing, and that they seem to link that as an issue as to why there's been that increase. But obviously, you all know that I led on the call in relation to children centres. So the council back in 2014, I think, reduced the number of children's centres and also the services provided out of them. So is it still your view that that reform, as you would put it at the time of the call, and has served as well? Has it provided some issues for us going forward?
I think I'm always aware when we take funding out of services, because that's always something that we would challenge in terms of being able to evidence a way forward. However, I think at the time of the review of children's centres, but what we didn't do is we didn't lose any of the buildings. So children's centre activity still takes place in the majority of those buildings across the borough, not necessarily by the service itself, but by our schools, by our voluntary sector, and by our parents and communities who use those buildings. So the buildings are all still in action, although used in a different way. The cluster of children's centres was something at the time that was being advised by Ofsted, who was still at that point inspecting children's centres. They're not currently inspecting children's centres because the inspection of children's centres has moved into the safeguarding inspection and other inspections that take place across the piece. I think that what we're more clearly able to evidence is the usage of those children's centres and how they tie into the wider early help offer, whereas previously they'd sat as a standalone offer and within a community level. So there's much more collaboration across the children's centres, and I think that in terms of the improving outcomes across the Ready for School pledge, we can see that they're doing what they need to do in terms of the pledge that was set, and we are now starting to hold our own in terms of national and regional predictions for data. So we've got closer, we still have some outline, but we've got closer to what is required of the offer than we previously were.
I'm moving on to a different topic, so
okay.
Council McLaughlin's got
how
we
were in
the... Well, I was going to raise two areas, but they're probably linked, because the first area I wanted to look at is, and I was going to raise it later on when we're looking at the performance indicators, was on the impact of the anti-poverty strategy. And the question I wanted to ask, and you may want to answer it now, or you may want to leave it until later, is have we got any kind of data of what the impact of the rollout of universal credit will be on our poverty indicators, and what revisions are we making for that as a borough? But the other question I wanted to ask is the figure of 53 children in the 10 to 15 age group. Can I dig down a little bit into how that comes about and why we're so different from elsewhere? Is that something that's going wrong with identifying children earlier in life? Is it something that we're not moving children out of the care system? And what work is going on to understand what that figure is about?
Okay, I'll take the first question first, Councillor, in terms of the improving
Matt Chance's work, which was our poverty work around the rollout of the universal credit. And I know that the meeting to establish the tonight's meeting, that was something that we'll focus on. There is something that you might be, and I'll pull it up, and if you can see, I can't very well. But this is on the Councillor Net, which is frequently asking questions of Councillor, so it's gone on to debt. Yeah, so if anybody wants that, we can have it, but that's on Councillor Net. The launch is due tomorrow for the Universal Credit, and I think that there's still quite a way to go. What we'll do is we can invite Julie Graham to the next meeting of this, where Julie Graham leads on the poverty work, the improving life chances work. And in terms of work that we're doing, I think there was a huge trigger point from that conversation that has led us to move forward to take up a small working group from a children's perspective. So there's still a lot of work to do. But there's two additional documents that we'll put on the council now on Monday. One's a council DWP referral form, and there's a local DWP job centre contact list in terms of information that's coming through. So I think there's a drip feed of information starting to come through.
Okay, look, I think the point I would probably want to stress is there's certainly a link between increasing the poverty of children and children who are in danger of coming into the system. It's extra stress. And that's just something I just want to look over a period of time, hopefully, as how we as a council are able to contribute to try and reduce that impact.
Yeah.
And we feel that's going to happen. But,
I think it was worth the conversation that we had in terms of starting to look, and it is something that we're taking very, very seriously in terms of data and intelligence through Carly's team to make sure that we understand our position better going forward than we have done looking back.
And the other was on the older children community cases.
The second bit, I'll start that and I'll hand on to Simon to give you a current position. In terms of the 53 children coming into the looked after system, who are 53 for 10,000, who are children between 10 and 15. There are some complexities there. I think a number of those children have been in the system for quite a long time, so they didn't come in as older children. So it's what we've done previously. And I think that for a number of those children, I'm not sure that the care planning in terms of the long-term care planning needs to be more robust.
Yes, I think just to echo what Deborah said, our profile of taking children into care shows us that we do not take into care more older children than we would expect. In fact, actually, our numbers of older children coming into care are slightly on the low side, if I'm being honest. We have expected numbers of children coming into care at a very young age, and that's very positive. We see a spike around 4 to 5 with an increase of children coming in there, and that's been the plan for some time. Now, when you've got very young children coming into care, babies up to the age of 4 to 5, adoption is usually a good route for leaving care if you can't return to your family in some way. By the time you get to 4 or 5, if you're coming into care at that stage, adoption is possible, but is much more challenging. If we don't act quickly when these children come into care with us, and there's a period of time, by the time that child reaches 5, 6 or 7, if there isn't already an extended family member on the horizon, our chances of moving that child out of care become less and less. By the time that child has been in our care for 6 to 12 months and is getting to the age of 10, it's usually they're going to remain with us for the rest of their time in care, and what we need to plan for is taking them forward. What we've been doing historically is focusing on looking after our looked after children well, and that came through in the inspection report when they came, inspectors saw some better work with our looked after children. What we haven't been doing, which is the start of the work we have now commenced, is looking at what we call permanence. And by that, I don't mean permanently staying in care. In fact, I mean just the opposite. I mean permanently finding a home that is appropriate for you forever. And that actually it starts with that best place is probably your family to get permanence. If you can return to your family, you should be, and you should be staying with them and be supported to grow in your family if that's possible. If that's not possible, then we have to seek permanence to other solutions, and we are looking at the way we do that. But I can't stress enough, and it's teaching and learning and policies that we are putting in place now to help our school groups understand this. Permanence for looked after children doesn't start 6 months into their time of being looked after. You have to think about permanence when you first think that that child might become looked after. Because the steps you take at that point and the things that you do then actually can have an impact further up the line in the way you do it. So for us, this is rethinking about our children's journeys going through the whole system. So to actually move those children out of care and to change the way we think, we need to focus on where those journeys start, getting it right there, and actually focusing on what's the long-term goal for this child to get them for that forever family. And I have to say, I don't think that's the way we've been thinking, looking at our stats up to now, but that's something we're trying to drive very much with social workers, with partners and other agencies to get it right for children. So the good news is, actually, in this case, managing the budget and getting it right for children do actually run closely together.
Okay.
Paul,
we have
another
question?
Yeah, being a witness where Councillor McLaughlin's putting in terms of what she said, why are we so different from elsewhere? Because I think there is a narrative out there that this borough, having high numbers of looked after children, just the care group at night or in the past 7 years, but from the presentation you've just given, Debbie, you talked about legacy issues, historic position being quite concerning, so that's not the case, is it?
So
it's not the case that we suddenly got high numbers of looked after children over the past 7 years then?
No. The legacy issues tell us that when we started to look at data, we can probably take it further back than that, where our numbers of children in the looked after system were high. And that has continued to be the case. I reiterate, the children that are coming in at the moment are children that need to be, and our numbers of children in terms of some of our statistical and regional neighbours continue to probably rise a little bit quicker than ours at the moment, but we're still down in that quartile of being amongst the highest at the moment, yes.
Yeah,
no,
that's okay, Paul?
Yeah, two quick things if I may. I was a little surprised. The ADCS stats say that 3 in 10 children are living in poverty, but on our figures for Wirral, we're saying it's only 22 out of 100, which is, so it's 20, so that's 30 is the national average, and we're only 22. I'm surprised that we are actually below the national average. But my question really is this. On those ABCS stats, refers to £1 spent on preventative health and £4 on reactive support. Is there anything out there which suggests that if actually that pound became £2, the £4 would... what evidence have we got? And it ties in with the pre-birth pathway and the Asian group that is there. What argument can be put forward that says putting more resource in that area would actually have positive outcomes and effectively reduce the bill later on?
Okay, I think that Simone's made quite a case in terms of children where we know those children earlier. There's two chances. One is if those children very early come into the care system, their permanence planning